Hello everyone, my name is Luis Rodriguez with Ultimaker, and I'm pleased to welcome Kevin from Decathlon. We've asked you here today to sort of share your story. I know you've been with Ultimaker for a little bit, and you're also new and helping things inside the company. So tell us a little bit.
Yeah, for sure. At Decathlon, we want to bring sport available for the many. So for do that, we need to reduce the cost. And before our entities of prototyping was created, we were like putting externally our prototyping phase. So it was not cost effective, and so on. We decided to go intern, and that's why we create our entity about prototyping. And rapidly we reach other company like Ultimaker to get the good 3D printer, and also to have a partnership about how to improve each other, and to also get the most the best of 3D printer.
So you used to outsource the prototyping?
Yeah, before that, yeah. And we, by internally prototyping, we keep our data. It was like the main point of
Yeah, you can
security.
Protect your IP.
Exactly.
Okay. And so you're part of a new group that was formed
inside
the company.
About additive manufacturing, we really feel the need of explore this field, because before that we are conceptors and we are seller retailer, but we need to know how it's going on, what's going
right.
on with the
additive. You need to have control of that workflow.
Exactly. Yeah.
So people may not realize you're a large sports brand, but you also do work for the brands that are carried in the store.
Exactly, yes. We're dealing with every sport, every kind of sports, and each of them needs validation of design, or sometimes mechanical structures. So that's why we had a lot of cases, and we have a range of different technology.
Right, so you have a lot of application uses. I even heard you're using some actual parts in stores for shelving, things like that.
Yeah.
I mean, I know now that you're a group, they're going to want to use you for everything.
Yeah.
What about materials? Have you explored a wide material range, or has that evolved?
Yeah, we had a chance to use composites also. For the first phase of conception, we basically prototype with FDM, because it's quicker and is enough to validate some shapes and assembly also. But we can use carbon fiber, for example. We had some example of a guard for protection, because the IP, the engineer and the designer wanted to test it in real application.
Okay.
Of the protection.
So it was a functional prototype.
Yeah, it's a functional prototyping.
What Ultimakers do you use? I know you have evolved.
Oh yeah, we started with Ultimaker 3 extended, because what we needed is the most accurate resolution.
Okay.
Z-axis, and for the 3 extended, it was a really it was a need.
Okay.
Inside, from internal.
So you had good surface quality.
Yeah, and to have like a part of the shoes, we wanted a lot.
Okay.
We also printed, but after all. After us, we get the S5.
Okay.
We had the chance to print a larger piece, and
right.
that was our need.
So you weren't cutting up parts. You were.
Yeah, before that, it was cutting parts and fixing after okay. all, and.
So now you can do pieces like this, where it's all one piece.
Yeah, and exactly. And it's really interesting, because thanks to the S5, the build volume is really interesting.
Yeah.
And we have some features that help us to not ruin. A large or long 3D prints, or yeah.
And then elsewhere in the company, are you also doing tooling and jigs and things for these products or other products? You started to do that yet?
So far, we're focusing on the additive manufacturing, and we sometimes did do a lot of, the post-treatment and the surfacing also. So coating and so
okay.
We try to get the most realistic prototype of it.
Okay. So what did the S5 give you beyond the size? You started to explore composites, or?
Yeah, composite also. Thanks to the last spring course, you see red,
yeah.
0.6, we had the chance to 3D print a tennis racket.
Oh, okay.
And we wanted to reach a mechanical structure.
Okay.
With the fiber, carbon fiber, yeah.
Okay.
So far, I know there is a lot of there's a large range, different of
lots of composites out there.
Yeah, composite and material. So I didn't try everything.
But you can if you want.
Yeah,
to.
Yeah, exactly.
So what's the plan inside the company now that you this is a successful business unit? You're starting to use it for more things. Are you going to expand this to other sites, or do you train other employees? It's just you.
Our goal is we are a small team right now dedicated to additive manufacturing. Okay. But because we are not the only ones thinking about additive manufacturing inside our Decathlon.
Okay.
So we wanted to federate all of these people. There is several parts of in France and also abroad in Taiwan, in Russia. They're starting to use additive manufacturing for not also prototyping, but thinking about the next step.
Right.
So our goal is to federate, give the good insight, because we try everything, we fail.
Right, you can share what you
learn. So we make some parameters. I mean, we put it in order to make the work easier for the other one.
So they can start off at the same level.
So we're starting to construct a network
of
additive manufacturing experts inside Decathlon.
Okay.
So we will maybe in the near future, like say we can produce locally,
right?
Some
ship
some
a file.
Parts.
Yeah.
Because our entity AdLab at Decathlon don't do only prototyping, but we're also looking at after sales, and we already product some parts that we can produce on demand.
Okay.
So economically and also
for repairs or upgrades.
Exactly. Yeah, and tooling also.
Okay.
I was thinking like because thanks to all of the composite we can do with ABM,
yeah.
We can do tools that doesn't exist with
specialized tools for the sporting
properties. Yeah.
Okay.
And so far we had a lot of demand from the inside.
Okay.
For some tooling. So.
Oh, that's great.
Thanks to Ultimaker S5 and also all of the composite.
You'll be able to explore that. So maybe one day all of these sites will have Ultimakers and you just ship a file.
Exactly, yeah. And with the right parameters and
right.
Slicer, thanks to Cura also, and the federation with Cura Connect, like everyone gets the same parameters and everything works fine.
Will you be involved with training the others?
I train my team.
Okay.
So my part of my job is to make everything smooth on the workflow. So yes, I tried and get the good parameters for our application and share it with the team. So everyone is up to date.
So once you convinced your superiors that you wanted to do this, what was the sort of the final decision? Was it turnaround time, cost? Was it how easy it was to use software? Because a lot of companies don't want their engineers to waste time learning software. They want it to be easy to use and maybe grow into it or something.
Yeah, but from our point, it's like we are cross technology.
Okay.
And we wanted to have control from the inside. So that's why we dig in deeper on the software to have the right parameters we needed for the right application. So
and then you create profiles.
It was okay. If it's easier and plug and play, why not? If you get the result.
Mm-hmm.
But because we can use any different materials, we wanted to have all of the panel of parameters. So.
Okay. So then you'll drill down per application, get a profile, and then you guys share those profiles?
Yes.
Okay.
And it's our strength.
So it might be per material, but it could be per product?
Yeah.
Per shape?
Why not?
Okay. Well, thank you, Kevin, for sharing what you do. We really thank you for stopping by and
thank you, Liz.
Taking the time. We're excited to see where you go and expand. And we want to do these to help, tell the story so people can relate. It is possible. Thank you, everyone, for watching. If you want to find out more about using our products in office environment, please make sure to download the white paper.